Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
Dr. John Nicoletti has specialized in police and public safety psychology as well as crisis intervention for almost 40 years. He joins Denver D.A. Mitch Morrissey to talk about trauma and what we can all do to be more healthy on this edition of Dialogue Denver D.A. Welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. Mitch, so great to see you again.
Good to see you, Tamara.
We have an awesome guest today. We always have awesome guests, but I really like Dr. John Nicoletti. We've worked over the years on crime stories and psychology, and it's really great to have you on the show.
Thank you for inviting me.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and background for people who don't know your background and what you've done.
Well, I'm a police psychologist, and I actually started working with law enforcement many years ago with Denver when they were just developing their, you know, police psychological services program, and then kind of expanded into the area of trauma and violence risk assessments and dealing with those type of issues.
So it's primarily police officers, but I understand, Mitch, your staff also worked with John, or John worked with your team.
Yeah, well, what happens, Tamara, is that we actually have somebody on call every night or all day, all the time. And what that means is that we then have a limited number of people that get called into scenarios that the police are investigating. So oftentimes, I can tell you, I've probably been to over 100 homicide scenes. And sometimes the victim has been taken away by an ambulance. They were still alive at the time they were at the scene, but oftentimes they're there. And oftentimes you see how they died, and you see the violence, you see the injuries. I've seen them dig victims up that were buried along next to a house up on Albion Street. We had a serial murderer up there. So I have people that are exposed to that kind of vicarious trauma, but also just dealing with victims, and that whole issue sometimes really starts to wear on my staff. And so when that happens, we call on Dr. Nicoletti to help us with those individuals that just need someone to talk to and need to work through those processes. It's tough. It's tough. We are kind of second responders, but we're there too. We're there seeing it and living it.
So, Dr. Nicoletti, it sounds like vicarious trauma is, you know, as Mitch mentioned, it's not something that you've gone through, but the people that you're dealing with have gone through, and sort of permeating onto you. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, well, stress and trauma are both contagious. They're communicable diseases. So, like, if you're around a stressful person, you'll get that, and you'll find yourself amping up with them. But people don't realize trauma is contagious, too. People think the only way you can get a traumatic reaction is to be a victim of trauma, but responding to somebody else's trauma, you get contaminated with. It's kind of like radiation. The more you're around it, the more contamination you get.
It's, you know, we see on TV, on Law and Order and CSI and such, that each week the characters come back and they're fresh and bright and like nothing happened. But that's not really how it works in reality with police officers, district attorneys, and other folks who are dealing with the people who are going through these horrible situations.
Right. It's kind of what we call too much, too ugly, too long. You just keep seeing these images, and once we get an image or a sound, we can't get rid of it.
Is there sort of a measurement that you can use to say, okay, this person has been working in this particular field, say homicides, for X amount of months and probably should pull them off? Or are there specific signs that you look for in a police officer or a staff member or a district attorney that sort of says this person needs to like take some time?
Yes, there are. The unfortunate thing, like folks in Mitch's office or in law enforcement, they're dedicated people and they start getting these symptoms and signs, but they're very dedicated and they think, oh, I can work through it. So pretty much what we look for is, you know, the intensity of the emotion. Like, you can have a certain emotion right now, but if it's not too intense, nobody knows it. So as the emotion's intensity starts to grow, the trauma, the depression, or the intrusions, pretty soon the body can't contain it, and then you start getting what's called interference, where it seeps and leaks out. So when you start seeing things coming out, then you know that the person has been in that field too long or that assignment too long.
And how might that seep out? How might that manifest itself?
Well, there are two things we look at with trauma. One is called an intrusion. The other is called a flashback. So an intrusion is like Mitch said, you go to a crime scene and you see somebody that was buried and you get away from there and you go to bed and you close your eyes and you keep seeing it. Or you keep hearing somebody scream. So that's what an intrusion is. A flashback is where you're fine, but then there's a stimulus or a triggering event similar to that event, and all of a sudden it brings back all the emotions. So those are the two things we see, the intrusions and the flashbacks.
And then could then that person act out on a loved one in a negative way?
Yeah, I mean, they may not necessarily act out on a loved one, but they may just be different. You know, the family members, as things start to seep out, the first people to obviously pick it up would be your family members. It's what we call deviation from baseline. You used to be this type of person. Now you're changing.
Mitch, is there a stigma that comes with going to Dr. Nicoletti and asking for help and asking his team for help?
You know, I can't really comment on the police side of that. I don't believe there is. I think that Dr. Nicoletti has established himself, at least with the Denver Police Department, and I know with other departments, with our office, that we realize that. It's time. I mean, I have to go into my family violence unit where kids are the victims all the time and say, hey, it's time for you to step away. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you a different assignment. Or I need you to go talk to this person. That type of thing. That's part of my role as the District Attorney of Denver. But, no, this has been going on long enough that, you know, you're going to get people, no, I don't need that or that type of thing. But, you know, people realize it, and if somebody comes to them and says, hey, now's the time, you need to do this, I'm starting to see this, and of course I'm their boss. So, you know, if push comes to shove, it's you're going to see Dr. Nicoletti. I have never had anyone that came back and said that I made the wrong choice doing that, that you made me do it, but it helped, or yes, you were right, I needed that. But I've never had anybody come back and say, that was bad, that was horrible, I didn't need it, because they did. And unfortunately, I have seen people in my course in the 30 years that I knew needed it, but I wasn't the DA. And I approached Mr. Ritter at least once and said, listen, this is what I'm seeing, this is what's going on, you need to do something. But, you know, you can see people go through divorces, start to drink, those types of things that start to be the outcome of being exposed to this day in and day out. And you really have to watch yourself. The young people I hire, I tell them, you have to have a normal life. You have to have normal friends. You have to have those things like running, softball, whatever it is you do, you need to keep doing, because this job can eat you alive. It can become all, it can absorb you, and it can change you a lot. You start to feel like, well, everybody's trying to get over on you. The defense attorneys are always trying to run a fast. Yeah, and you start to get an overall attitude about the world that isn't right. You know, you walk down to 17th Street and there's a lot of things going on down there, or you go over to the park that we don't see if you stay in this courthouse all the time, and if you listen to those stories day in and day out and make those arguments, it really does take its toll on you.
I can imagine. And I'm wondering if it's just police officers and district attorneys. Can this also happen to the average citizen? Maybe people watching the news or neighbors who've seen horrible things happen to their neighbors next door?
Oh, yeah, and even more so to those folks, because they're now trained like folks in this field, so when they get traumatized, it's huge.
And is there, how much, I guess, counseling or training then would you need to give somebody? I'm sure that depends on the circumstance, but can somebody get back on the streets again as an officer fairly quickly, or back in the courtroom, or what does that look like?
Oh, totally. It all depends on how quickly in the contamination process they decide to get help. Trauma is like cement. you know, when you first pour it, you can move it around, but then if you wait too long, it starts solidifying, and one day it's a solid block. So the longer you wait, the harder it is to, you know, de-escalate it. And if you wait too long, PTSD is a permanent disorder. So if I'm working with somebody who truly has PTSD, I'm not going to cure that. The best I can do is teach you how to live with the symptoms, the intrusions and the flashbacks and all those other things.
Well, I think that's a really interesting point that I'm not sure many people would know, that PTSD is a permanent disorder. So you want to get to people before they get to that point, right?
Yeah.
Is there any, certainly our loved ones can see some things and our coworkers, but is there anything, you know, maybe you're single or you just have a really good way of camouflaging it to the rest of the world. What should the officers and district attorneys and others look for in themselves to recognize some signals?
Well, the first step is being honest with yourself. You know, you can fool everybody else and pretend and kind of run a con on everybody, but don't try and do that on yourself. And the other thing we try and get across is, somewhere along the line in our development, we decided to separate physical from psychological. And one of the biggest things I can hear from somebody that tells me they're going to have a hard time is they're going through a traumatic experience, they're having symptoms, and they say to Mitch or whoever, this shouldn't be bothering me. That's a bad sign. We would never do that in the physical world. That would be like, you know, you're cutting trees down with a chainsaw, and you cut your leg open, you'd never say to yourself, gee, I shouldn't be bleeding.
Yeah. Right.
Because if you did, you'd bleed out. So psychologically, if we say this shouldn't be bothering me, you're going to let yourself bleed out.
So it's, I think you mentioned the term, is it deviating from the norm? Things say
the
maybe
baseline the way they used to be.
Right. So maybe you're crying more often than you typically would, or maybe lack of sleep, those sorts of things?
Any of those. It could be physiological, it could be psychological, you know, it could be, you know, a variety of internal symptoms. You're not the type of person. You're drinking more, your sleeping's disturbed, you're withdrawing from your family, you have a cynical outlook on life.
Mm-hmm. This is a really interesting topic, and I know that a lot of our viewers are interested in this because this does impact not just the officers and the district attorneys, but the community as a whole. So we're going to be back with more Dialogue Denver DA with Mitch Morrissey and our guest, Dr. John Nicoletti, just a moment. We'll be back. Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. This is part of the program where we talk about a legal term, and today our legal term is reverse. It's an action of a higher court in setting aside or revoking a lower court decision. So, Mitch, it sort of sounds like it speaks for itself. The decision was reversed for whatever reason.
Well, it's part of an appeal, and there's really two outcomes of an appeal. The appellate court can affirm the judgment or the conviction in a criminal case, or it can reverse the holding of the lower court. So when we see it, it's usually from the Court of Appeals, because everything gets appealed to them out of our district court. They're the ones that rule, and then we can appeal to the Supreme Court. And if they take it, they don't have to. But if they do, they can then reverse the Court of Appeals. So, and that can go all the way through up to the United States Supreme Court. Denver is actually, while I've been in the Denver DA's office, we've taken a couple of cases all the way to the United States Supreme Court, which reversed the Colorado Supreme Court. and reversed all the way down to the district court in a decision based on the voluntariness of his statement. Mm-hmm. So you get a ruling from the trial court judge, or you'll get a decision by the jury, and then it will be appealed, and one of the outcomes is it gets reversed. And I think that a lot of times people don't understand. What that means is we're back at square one. The case doesn't go away. Mm-hmm. We just retry the case. If a case gets reversed, then if we can, we bring it again, and we have another trial, start all over again.
Due process takes a while sometimes, and the wheels of justice kind of grind along.
It does, yes.
Getting back to our topic and our guest, Dr. John Nicoletti, unfortunately, here in Colorado, we've seen so many mass shootings and huge trauma with Columbine, Oklahoma City bombing trial, another high school shooting. There were a movie theater shooting. It kind of puts us in this kind of weird position of being, I say us, you, really, of being an expert in helping people and first and second responders. Has that kind of happened to you, that you've been on many, if not all, of these scenes helping the people who are helping others?
Yes, I have. And then you're exactly right. Like when I do a presentation out of state, first question I always get is, how come you all have so many of these things in Colorado?
Yeah. How do you answer that?
I answer, I have no clue.
Yeah. Are there things that you've been able to learn, if there's an upside from these situations, that you've been able to learn, say, from Columbine in, 1999, to the Aurora movie theater shooting in 2012?
Oh, definitely. I think that's a good analogy. In Columbine, we were all caught off guard, and, you know, that's most of our first time dealing with mass casualties. And, you know, we were there on scene and stuff, and, you know, available for the responders, and a lot of folks took advantage, but some didn't. So what we learned from there, and there were a lot of responders coming, but they weren't trained in trauma. So like what we did in Jeffco is we trained everybody, credentialed them, so if you respond to these, you have to go through a basic training on trauma response. And like with the Aurora Theater shooting, what we did is, you know, did outreach to every single responder rather than waiting for them to come in. We you know, went to them and stuff, and that I think helps mitigate the trauma reaction. So.
In cases like that, in that magnitude, is it fairly certain to say that everybody's going to experience some sort of trauma that they need to deal with? And I mean everybody in terms of the responders.
Oh, totally. And even people around. I mean, because what the Aurora Theater shooting did is shatter our assumptions about our safety zone, about movies are comfortable places. There are folks to this day that have not been able to go back to movie theater because they haven't figured out a way to rebuild those shattered assumptions.
I fall asleep in movies when I go, so I always tell my wife that I can't go because of the, you know, the post-traumatic stress from the...
Right, that's your way out to take her out.
I just fall asleep when they turn the lights off.
Yeah.
But no, I really do believe we've seen that. The other thing that I think that was important, and I know in the Aurora shooting, what happens at those things is a lot of people show up. Elected officials show up. You know, Ed Perlmutter, he represents that area. He's going to be there. Senators showed up. The governor shows up. I think that we've unfortunately learned a lot about they show up and then they want to see mm-hmm. what happened. And I know specifically that the Mobile Crime Lab, they went in and videotaped some things that went on. They did the whole thing in documentation. And what they prevented in being able to show video footage as opposed to tours through the theater, that was really the difference in some of the way things were handled from Columbine to that theater shooting. Hmm. And that's technology that's being used differently. That's learning from those horrible events what it is that you're going to be confronted with, what it is you're going to see, and what's a good way to deal with it. It's always amazed me, that phenomenon of kind of the people that show up and want a tour.
Yeah.
People are there trying to do their job, and they're confronted with this trauma and these horrible things, and then you've got these people, and you understand why they're there. The mayor is going to be there. You understand why they're there, but sometimes they're just in the way. And we've dealt with ways, we've come up with ways to deal with them so they aren't doing the types of things that would impact the crime scene, but also expose them to this trauma.
Right. Because as you mentioned earlier, it's contagious. And they weren't there in that particular schoolroom or a library or theater, but hours later, they're there and there's still blood, you know, or there might even still be victims there. And you can
or sounds. I mean, there's all sorts of things. Yeah, and we always tell people who, like what Mitch says, they're not trained, they want to go in there and say, careful what you ask for.
Yeah, yeah. When you have, this is probably a no-brainer question, but when you have a healthy police force and district attorneys, your staff, who are able to take these situations and deal with them properly and then be able to get back to work at a proper time, I mean, the whole community kind of benefits, doesn't it? I mean, you don't want people out on the streets who are dealing with maybe what is now PTSD and they're trying to do their job, right? I mean, now you've got... there's some real problems on the streets if that happens.
Yeah, and I think you're exactly right. It's a bad way to frame it because we've had so many in Colorado. I think our law enforcement, our district attorneys are very resilient compared to like Newtown where they've never had anything like that. So, mm-hmm.
I think that what you see too, and there are periods of time, you know, when you've been around as long as we've been around, 30 years, you observe things. And you'll see a higher level of DUIs in the police department when there's an area or a time of a lot of stress. Something's going on there as an agency and you start to see this increase of officers getting drunk driving scenarios and that type of thing. And you have to watch that and kind of try to figure out what's causing it, but also to try to address it in a way that we invest a lot of money training these people. We need their expertise. I need people that can try cases. I need investigators that can put together a trial, victim advocates that, you know how to deal with victims. And if I lose them because they become disabled as a result of the trauma that they're seeing every day, that hurts the taxpayers, that hurts the community. And I think that that's part of my role to help to get the assistance and support that we need to continue to be a healthy office.
How do you walk that fine line, though? Because you don't want to become so desensitized that you just have sort of a callous facade to the victims and their families, but you also don't want to be consumed by the fear and the trauma and the pain. How do you try to walk that fine line? What advice do you have?
Well, it's like what Mitch said. I mean, what we try and do when we're working with folks with trauma is we try and get the trauma to go from a thought, which is right here, mm-hmm. to a memory. Now, what do I mean by memory? You know, if I asked you, what'd you have for dinner March 12th? In order for you to answer me, what would you have to do? You'd have to kind of access that information. Mm-hmm. So that's where we want the trauma to go to become a memory. So PTSD are folks who've never moved it to the memory. So what we're trying to do is get them to move it to that thing. And one of the key things, like Mitch mentioned earlier, is balance. If all you're seeing is death and destruction, your eyes have to see something different. And if all you're hearing is screams, you got to hear something different.
Right, so make sure you have some time for play. What other things can people do, if you can sort of share what your counseling looks like or the snapshot of that?
Well, the biggest thing, you know, general stress, and you all know this, when you get stressed, you can go work out, you can go out to dinner, you can do a variety of things, and it'll purge it. Trauma, unfortunately, the only way we can move it to our memory center is we have to literally talk about it. We have to purge it. Mm-hmm. We have to do the things people don't want to do. It's like, I don't want to visit this again. But the only way to move it to memory is you got to embrace the dragon.
And what does that look like? I mean, do you literally take people through that scenario again and say, yeah, let's talk about it?
Where are you stuck at, yeah.
So you look at that monster underneath the bed.
Yeah.
Is that, I can imagine that's got to be tough for folks.
It's tough for folks, but living with that monster forever is tougher.
Does it take, I kind of asked you this before, but I'm not sure we got a clear answer. Does it take a long time? Or does it depend on how deep that trauma.
Well, it depends on the degree of exposure, the resiliency of the person, how quickly they obtained health. You know, people who do it early, they can process it quickly.
Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit about the overall goal of resiliency, and what does that mean?
Well, it's a term everybody uses now. It's almost a bumper sticker term, resiliency. But the only truly way you know you're resilient is if you've met adversity and you've been able to bounce back. I mean, that's really what adversity is. And it's kind of like Darwin, survival of the fittest. Survival of the fittest goes to the species that adapts the quickest. And so that's what we're looking at. How do you adapt and how do you overcome that?
And is there, I'm sure there's a difference between adapting and stuffing it down.
Right.
Right. And so how do we know, how do you know the difference?
Well, sometimes I don't, but you would. If you stuff it down, it's still haunting you. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the biggest. Are you still, are the ghosts and demons still running around in your head, or are they gone?
It might manifest itself in illnesses.
Yeah.
I know a lot of trauma has been directly related to, not always, but sometimes cancers and different kinds of illnesses in the body.
Oh, yeah. Any major thing, you know, any major illness or psychological issue or alcoholism or suicide, you know, trauma, it's hiding back there.
You know, he talks, when I listen to this conversation and he was up at our conference talking, and he did a whole morning presentation to our lawyers, old and young, and investigators and people that were there. And I started to, this whole concept of memory, and I started to think about those homicide scenes that I have been to. And I have a picture of every single one of them somewhere in my mind. And I was able to call them back up while he was talking about that. And so when I think about a homicide that I went to, maybe the first one, I have a picture of what that was like, what I saw, what I was exposed to somewhere. And I can draw it up. I can visually draw almost a still picture of how that person was laying, what they had, what I saw, not what they went through, but what I saw when I came into that scene.
And that has a definite impact, I'm sure. And
it's all very real.
Yeah,
this
yeah.
is all real.
And we call it the Book of the Dead, and all of us have, you know, some people have more chapters than other people, but we all have the Book of the Dead.
Wow. Well, the work that you do for the first responders, second responders, and the community is phenomenal. So thank you so much for being on the show and doing all the great work that you do.
Thank you for inviting
Thanks.
Me.
Thanks. We can't always avoid traumatic events, but it is good to know there are tools and people out there to help deal with it. Thank you to Dr. John Nicoletti for being our guest today with Denver D.A. Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver D.A. We'll see you next time.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.